Hello, FTC teams, and welcome to our judging and awards video series. My name is Annika, and I'm from FTC Team 9794, Wizards.exe. We're a fourth-year team from Rockville, Maryland, in the United States of America, and our team mission is to engage, expand, and educate full teams and communities to promote STEM and FIRST through our outreach and training programs. This video series is all about helping teams navigate the judging and awards process in FTC. We have split this up into three main parts. The first video, which is what you're watching right now, is an introduction and the breakdown of all of the seven awards and what their metrics are. The second video is all about the do's and don'ts of the judging interview, so how to engage your judges, what the key points to highlight are, and stuff like that. Our third video will go over pit judging and the process of that. In the middle of your screen, you will see a QR code. You're welcome to scan this QR code to access our full slide deck and download that if you want to. Let's get into it. So what's the point of a qualifier? Yes, the qualifier is the first event of your season. It's all about advancing to the higher levels, but it's very important to remember that this is not the main focus. A qualifier is all about celebrating your accomplishments and your season by sharing your experiences with other teams and with the judges. So when I was in FLL, the league before FTC in the first programs, there wasn't so much interaction among teams. We were all kind of caught up in our own things. But in FTC, it's so incredible to be able to meet kids, students who have the same interests as you do from different states and countries all over the world. So make sure to let loose a little bit, have a good time, meet new people, and enjoy the qualifier. It's not all about the awards. The qualifier structure will vary a little bit from region to region, but the general structure is this. In the morning, you will have a 15-minute judging interview. You'll have a 5-minute uninterrupted presentation followed by 10 minutes of Q&A. Depending on your region, you may be able to continue presenting during this 10-minute Q&A, but the judges are able to interrupt you throughout, ask you questions, and you have to answer them as you go. So be prepared for that. In the afternoon, you will have a pit judging session, which is a follow-up from the interview. If in the interview, say, the judges like you for a very particular award, they can have the pit judging members come back to see you in the afternoon to ask you questions targeted towards that award. So pit judging is more focused on particular awards. At the same time as pit judging, you're going to have the robot competition, and this makes for quite a busy day. So it's important to stay organized throughout your qualifier and your competition. We'll cover some tips for being organized later on in our video series. Let's get into the awards next. It's very important that you prepare for the awards throughout your season. The most important thing to do is to read Game Manual Part 1, Sections 4, 5, and 10. Sections 4 and 5 have an overview of tournament day and what the structure of the whole day looks like, and this will help you organize your team better for your event. Section 10 has the detailed criteria for all of the awards. Consider having a member on your team be the awards rule master, and this person can go back and check the awards criteria periodically, and especially right before your competition, to make sure that you meet the criteria for your targeted awards. The next thing to think about is the two categories of awards, engineering and outreach awards. There are 4 engineering awards and 2 outreach awards. So think about mentors that you can reach out to for engineering help, and think about how you can best connect with your community for the outreach awards, and what you think is going to make the biggest impact both on you and your community. It's also extremely important to identify your team goals for the season. Do you want to go for an award? If so, which award? It's pretty important to have a few awards in mind that you specifically target. Of course, you can go for all the awards if you want to, but if you can target 1 or 2 awards, you'll be better able to kind of channel your team's interests, your team's work, towards those 1 or 2 awards. You also want to think about what you want to accomplish with your robot. There's a lot to do and not a lot of time. It's a good idea to think about doing 2 or 3 tasks on the robot game reproducibly and consistently instead of trying to do everything and not being very reliable. It's a good idea to do some of the things all the time instead of all the things some of the time. You want to make sure that these goals are manageable for your team, your time commitment, and your experience level. So don't set goals that are so, so high that you can't reach them, because you'll just leave the season not feeling very satisfied. So set manageable goals. The first engineering award is called the Think Award, and it's all about the engineering notebook and design process. You want to clearly describe your team's journey in the notebook, both for the robot and for the outreach. Judges are only going to look at the notebook if you describe your design process well in the interview. They will look at the notebook for other awards regardless, but you want to clearly describe your design process in the interview if you're going for the Think Award. So talk about how you brainstorm, what your strategy is, your requirements, your brainstorming, your testing, and stuff like that. Make sure that they know that you're really thinking about the design process like an engineer. The notebook is not just for the Think Award, however. It's required for every single judged award. It's also how judges learn about your team. The first time they see you will likely be when you walk into a judging interview, and they don't have any prior knowledge about your team's work. So having a detailed notebook is how they know all about your team, what your efforts are, what your initiative is, and everything about you. There are also several rules and guidelines with the notebook. For example, you can have 2 notebooks maximum, and they can only be 3 inches tall each. There are a bunch of rules to follow, so you should check out these rules and guidelines that I've linked in the description to make sure that you are able to adequately present your notebooks so that they get looked at. It's such a shame if teams get disqualified for not following the rules. It's also important to remember that every judge only has a few minutes per notebook, so you want to have a clear summary sheet. It is a requirement to have a 1-page summary, but the clearer it is, the easier it is for judges to go through the notebook and hit the key points. You also want to include marked sticky notes on critical pages so that they can find the key points. You want to limit yourself to around 8 sticky notes or 10 at a maximum. If you have too many sticky notes, that doesn't really help the judges find the key points. You also want to label these. So for example, if it's an entry about prototyping the mineral mechanism, call it prototyping mineral mechanism or something like that. That way, if a judge is looking for a very particular thing for a particular award, it's easy for them to just look at the tabs and figure out where they want to go. You also want to determine how you're going to manage your notebook from the beginning. This is not something you can leave to the last minute. You can either have a very detailed notebook, a very simple notebook, or something in between, but you want to make sure that you have the clear vision right before the qualifier. It's very difficult to redocument everything right before the qualifier, so try and keep a running log of your work throughout the season, and consider having one person in charge and making sure that you're up to date with your notebook log and entries.
So there are 3 more engineering and design awards to consider. The first is called the Innovate Award, and this is all about a unique, elegant, and reliable solution to one or more tasks on the field, and explaining a clear design process for how you arrived at the solution. It's basically what sets your robot apart, what makes it different, and how you got there. An example of this is from our robot from 2 years ago. I'm not sure if you're familiar with the Velocity Vortex game, which is from 2 years ago, but one of the tasks was to lift a 1-kilogram yoga ball onto a center structure. This was called the cat ball task. On the right, you see a photo of our cat ball mechanism. We used 4 arms, while most teams use 2. In judging, we would say something sort of like, for our cat ball mechanism, we use 4 arms. This is innovative because most teams use 2 arms, kind of like a forklift. However, we found that using 2 arms often meant that you would get tangled up in the central structure, making it pretty hard to drop off the cat ball. By using 4 arms, you can just grab the cat ball, 2 at the bottom, 2 at the top, grab it, lift it, and drop it on top by opening up the arms. We found through testing that the cat ball would sometimes fall out of the bottom arms. So we 3D printed these 2 custom designed yellow pieces that you can see in the photo. And these kind of served as hooks to keep the cat ball in until we opened up the arms. That kind of is a summary of how we could talk about an innovative mechanism, because we explain why it's innovative. It uses 4 arms, not 2. Why we chose to use 4 arms. Using 2 arms often meant that you get stuck in the center structure, and our design process with the mechanism. We found that the cat ball would come out, so we made and printed 2 hooks to keep it in. That's a good way to talk about why you're unique, why it's elegant, and prove that it could be reliable, or that it probably is reliable because you tested it. It also covers the design process. The next award is called the Design Award, and this is all about using industrial design principles and balancing between form, function, and aesthetics. This means that your robot is very functional, but it also looks really nice, and it's robust. Using industrial design principles primarily means using CAD softwares. And it's a good idea to use CAD softwares before you build, not just for documentation. CAD allows you to design parts and mechanisms in a 3D system, basically, but not in real life. So you can catch potential flaws before spending time building it, and this can save you time in the long run. You can also consider things like 3D printing, laser cutting, custom fabrication techniques to help make you eligible for the design award. Anything that is designed like an engineer would in the real world, for example. The final engineering award is called the Control Award, and this is all about software. So using sensors and your autonomous program, how you make it easier to control the robot and make it easier for the drivers to drive it around, how you make the robot more self-aware. With a control award, the most important thing to do is to submit it. Unlike all of the other awards, the control award has a specific application that you must fill out to be eligible. The game manual has a control award sample submission sheet, so you can just take that and fill it in. Even if you don't think you have the best software, I think it's a good idea for every single team to apply for this award, because you never know, you might have great software and just not think it. So definitely apply for the control award, because it would suck to have great software, but then not be considered for it because you haven't turned it in. So check out the game manual for that submission, and I'll link that in the description as well. Now onto the outreach awards. There are two outreach awards. The first one is called the Connect Award, and this is about connecting the dots between community first and the diversity of the engineering world. But really, what does that even mean? This is all about your corporate and STEM communities and how you bring them into the first world. An example of this from our team is that we have mentors from the industry, from different engineering companies, small businesses, local firms, stuff like that, and we invite them to our monthly design reviews, where we cover our work over the past month on robot design and on outreach, and we get feedback from our mentors, engaging them in the first world. We also go on tours of local companies and businesses, like Stanley Black & Decker, to learn more about engineering. And this is kind of how we work with our corporate community. The next award is called the Motivate Award. And this is all about getting people involved in FIRST, exciting them about FIRST, being motivational and inspirational, in a sense. An example of this is going to elementary schools to get kids excited about robotics, hosting info sessions to teach the parents about the program, and then starting FLO Junior teams to get more kids involved in the program. The final award and the highest award is called the Inspire Award, which celebrates a team that is a strong contender in many award categories, meaning that they rank highly in all of the previous six categories. They're a role model team to other teams. The reliability of the robot is important, so you do have to have a reliable robot, but it does not carry more weight than any other category. So even if your robot is having an off day, you still could be eligible for this award. A common question we get is, well, how many awards can we win? At one event, you can be nominated for multiple awards, but can only win first place for one award. So let's say a team wins second place Think, third place Connect, third place Innovate, second place Design, whatever. But if they win first place Motivate, they can no longer win first place Control, if that makes sense. You can only be first place for one award, but you can still get nominations for other awards. If you win the first place Inspire Award, you cannot be eligible for it at another qualifier. So you can't be eligible for it at another event of the same level in any other region, but you could win it again at the next level of competition. So if you win it at a qualifier, you could not win it at any other qualifier, but you could then win it at the state level or the next level above that. That's pretty much it for the breakdown of all the awards. Make sure to check out the next part of our video series all about the judging interview. And if you have any questions, please email us at wizards.exe@gmail.com. Thanks for watching!